the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord, O let all that is in me adore him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people again, gladly forever adore him.
We're going to start our assembly this morning in a little bit different way, one of the best ways that I can imagine. We're going to have baptism. Georgia Hood, that's right. Georgia Hood has expressed her desire to confess her faith in Jesus and to put him on in baptism, and her father, Caleb, is going to perform that baptism right now. Y'all ready?
The Son and the Holy Spirit.
In the book of Deuteronomy, we read these instructions to parents to bind these commands upon your heart and teach them to your children. That's the responsibility of us as parents. And we have just witnessed the results of that teaching. I remember back in 1962 when the preacher of the church we attended, the Walnut Hill Church of Christ, came to me to talk to me about baptism. My parents did not feel it was their responsibility. They felt it was the preacher's responsibility. And I'm so glad it's different today. And what a great way to begin our service. Well, obviously, we're going to give thanks in this prayer for Georgia and her family. You know, the Hood family is exiting. Caleb is going to Beaumont to teach English at Lamar University, and they've made such a big impact here. And no one is indispensable, but there are those who are irreplaceable, and we will miss them. In this prayer, I'm also going to remember Carolyn Regini, who is Michelle Kelly's mother, who's in hospice, and Jean Mellencamp, who's really struggling with some situations with her health, and she's going to have to see a surgeon this week, and we want to remember her in prayer. So will you join me now? Father, we are so grateful to gather as your people. We praise you for your gifts. We praise you for the greatest gift of all, the gift of your Son. How encouraging, how inspiring it was to witness this father tell this story, tell this daughter the story of Jesus and how he came and how he came back to life. And Father, we confess and we acknowledge that we believe that story, and that's why we are here. We are here to sing our praises together. We are here to share the koinonia of our common life. We are here to share the supper, remembering the death of the Son and the salvation that brings to us. And Father, for all of that, we give you thanks and we give you praise. We're so thankful. We're reminded of the difference that every person makes in our church. Every person teaches another, even by their presence here this morning. And we're thankful for one another, the encouragement we receive from one another, and the responsibility we accept to offer that encouragement. Father, we pray that Michelle Kelly will be encouraged by your presence and that her mother, Carolyn, as she makes this transition into your personal presence, the presence of the Son, as she is in hospice, may she know that the presence of the Spirit, may she know the welcome of the Son in that blinking of an eye. Be with her, be with her family. Father, we also pray for Jean in her physical struggles and her physical distress, and we ask you to bring calming and peace and healing. Father, we know that grace and peace is the hallmark of how we're supposed to live, and we want to be your vessels displaying that to others. We have come here to share in your grace, and we have come here to offer your peace. Through this service, may we be prepared to offer both to those, everyone with whom we're in contact, especially your household, but may we be servants to all, Lord. We seek this empowerment this morning in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to him, where steady arms of mercy reach to gather children in. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Come, those whose joy is morning sun, and those weeping through the night. Come, those who tell of battles won, and those struggling in the fight. For his perfect love will never change, and his mercies never cease. But follow us through all our days with a certain hope of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Come, young and old from every land, men and women of the faith. Come, those with full or empty hands, find the riches of his grace. Over all the world his people sing, shore to shore we hear them call. Christ through every age, our God is all in all. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Rejoice, give thanks, and sing, and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart. up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. Jesus the Savior reigns, the God of truth and love. When he had purged our stains, he took his seat above. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. Rejoice in glorious hope, our Lord and Judge shall come and take his servants up to their eternal home. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, still believe. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. We believe in a God who is able to bring justice and mercy to all. And he promised his strength for the journey to the steadfast who answer the call. Let us be faithful, faithful, faithful Lord. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. Though we cannot see, we still believe. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. We believe in the truth of the Bible, in its power and purpose today. There is meaning and life in its pages. We believe and we choose to obey. Let us be faithful, faithful, faithful Lord. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. Though we cannot see, we still believe. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. We believe that he's calling his people to embody his story of grace, bringing rescue and hope to the broken. May our lives be an offering of praise. Let us be faithful, faithful, faithful Lord. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. Though we cannot see, we still believe. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. Let us be faithful. Let us be faithful. And though we cannot see, we still believe. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. Let us be faithful. Let us be faithful. And though we cannot see, we still believe. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord. Let us be faithful, faithful Lord.
Let's pray together. Faithful God, we lift our praises to you, and we rejoice today. We rejoice in you. We rejoice that you are on your throne. Father, we pray that our lives would be an offering of praise. We pray that you would Let us be faithful, that you would help us, that you would strengthen us, that you would provide us the resolve and the commitment and the dedication that we desire, that we strive for. We know that you have made the same power that was at work when Jesus was raised from the dead available to us today. And we pray that you will fill us, that you will awaken us, that you will use us as faithful servants, that you will use us as ambassadors of love in this world that needs love so badly. We thank you for sending Jesus to show us what that looks like. May we follow in his footsteps today and every day. In his name, amen.
Our scripture this morning is John 3, 16 through 21. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God.
I want to just acknowledge before we get started here that Wanda Sanders is here with us today. And I don't know if y'all know this, but yeah, Wanda has been through physical ailments for several years. And this last year was particularly difficult, but her and Niall are here this morning, their whole family, and hallelujah. We're glad that you're here. Another special recognition today. This weekend is Memorial Day weekend. Let's see if I can get this thing to work. Of course, Memorial Day weekend is especially for those who have died in the service to our country, but we want to acknowledge all of those among us who have served in the military or are serving in the military. So if y'all stand up and just let us show you our appreciation for your service. God bless y'all. I know they don't do it for the recognition, but a real recognition is good. Last week, I started a series of lessons entitled Revive Us Again, because I think you're like me. I think you want to be more passionate about God and more in love with Jesus Christ and more focused in your walk with them, more committed to the Holy Spirit and his work in your life. You want to be all of that more now and in the future, maybe, than you have in the past. Now, we acknowledge the fact that our spiritual lives are kind of like the stock market. Over time it goes up, but there are some setbacks and we don't all always go straight up. That wouldn't be realistic to even think about that. But I've been thinking about what is it that I need in my life so that as I walk through life and as I grow as a Christian and I grow in my discipleship, what is it that I need to do? What are the characteristics in my life that are important? What are the different attributes that I need? And so last week we started off talking about the commitments that we all need to make. If you haven't heard that sermon, I would encourage you to go online and listen to it. I'll tell you, this is my conviction. My conviction is that we as a church and as disciples of Jesus Christ, we have hard work ahead of us. And we've got to make up our minds now that we're going to be up for the task. Now, empowered by God, leaning on Him, trusting in Him. But we need to be making some decisions now that will allow us to prepare ourselves for the challenges that are ahead. And I'll guarantee you, there are challenges ahead. The last year, that's nothing. There will be challenges that far outstrip the pandemic, which is concerning to me. Because I'm not sure we did real well during the pandemic. And so I've been praying, God, revive us again. Do something new in us. Change our hearts. Bring us closer to You. Help us be more and more the people You're calling us to be, so that we can, as we'll look at this morning, we can shine like stars in this culture that we find ourselves. We live at a day and a time when God and His mission is not really important to most Americans. The center of global Christianity has shifted from the United States to sub-Saharan Africa. And pretty soon they will be sending missionaries here. And that's one of the reasons we want to become much more of a missional church, because things are not like they used to be. So last week we talked about commitment. This morning I want us to talk about integrity. The dictionary defines integrity as the quality or state of being complete, undivided, or incorruptible. Now, I think we have a tendency to compartmentalize our lives. I know it's kind of a cliche that men are especially good at this, that men are really good at compartmentalizing their work life and their family life and their spiritual life. I think we all do this. And I think one of the reasons we do this is because it allows us to be, should I put it like that? It allows us to be kind of inconsistent, because we have one set of values that we use for our work life, and we'll have another set of values that we'll use for our family life, and another set of values that we use for our spiritual life. And what God is calling us to do is not to be different depending on the situation. God is calling us to be the same in every situation. And so let's talk a little bit about integrity this morning. Why is it even important that we talk about this? Well, what is it about integrity that is so important? And I can think of at least three reasons. One is because integrity pleases God. Let us remember that God is integrity. God is truth. In John chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, "The Word became flesh and made His dwelling place among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of what? Grace and truth." Jesus is all about grace and truth. In the passage that Ken read in John chapter 3, verses 16 through 21, John is drawing this contrast between darkness and light. Jesus came as the light into the world, and the light and the world rejected the light because it's evil. And then he calls us to live in the light. Living in the light means we live in truth. We are people of truth. Now, that brings up a really interesting question. Whose truth? We live in a day and a time when, because of especially because of social media. There is more disinformation out there than ever before. I got off Facebook. I'm not on any social media. Now, I take that back. I'm not on it. I troll Twitter. I'll look at Twitter every now and then. I don't know what you call that. I don't post anything. But I got off Facebook. Let me tell you one of the reasons I got off Facebook. Because I saw repeatedly Christian people in this church post falsehood after falsehood after falsehood. And you know, if I tried to, because I think, well, surely they'd want to know that that's not true. And I might post something that points to another article or something else, and then they'd get mad at me. And I thought at some point, you know, this is just not worth it. I watched a documentary last night about the untruth that exists in our culture today. If something sounds true, or especially if it agrees with my political perspective, then I'll post it. I don't even care if it is true. I'll just put that out there because it sounds like it could be true. What I'm trying to tell you is that Christian people don't live that way. Because God is truth. And we are people of truth. And we pursue truth in every arena and area and aspect of our lives. We are not going to compartmentalize our lives. We're going to allow truth to bathe everything we do. Why? Because truth pleases God. He is the embodiment of truth. And so if I'm going to be a believer, what God demands from me is integrity and truthfulness in my actions, my words, and my thoughts. Why do we pursue integrity? Well, it pleases God. And above all, we want to do that. And then also we pursue integrity because it affects other people. Think about all the other people in your life. Think about your family, those who are at home. Proverbs 20, verse 7 says, good people who live honest lives will be a blessing to their children. Or think about the people in the world around us. There are a couple of Proverbs passages that are very familiar to a lot of us. Proverbs 11, verse 11, the influence of good people makes a city great. There's a Proverbs 14, 34, righteousness exalts a nation. How do you have a great city? How do you have a great nation? Well, you pursue integrity in everything that you do. And think about the people that are out there that don't know who Jesus is. Do you realize that integrity and truthfulness actually acts as a draw? I think it's because it's so rare in our culture today, because at every turn, people lie. And then you have someone who comes in and is willing to speak truth. Now, not in a harsh or ugly way, but to speak truth into people's lives. It shines as an example. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 12, people who do not believe are living all around you. Live such good lives that they'll see the good things you do and will give glory to God on the day when Christ comes again. Living with integrity, you making that choice, draws people to Jesus. It's really sad, but it's true. There are two reasons some people never become Christians. One reason is because they've never met a Christian. And the other reason is because they have met a Christian. It affects people around us, our integrity. And then I think another reason is that, I mean, this is selfish, but living with integrity just blesses me. The Bible says it benefits our lives when we are truthful, when we live with integrity in all areas of our lives. Proverbs 11 in the Message, verses 5 and 6, moral character makes for smooth traveling. An evil life is a hard life. Good character is the best insurance. And I told this morning, I told Paul McQueen I was going to quote Mark Twain. But this is what Mark Twain said. I tell you the truth. If you tell the truth, you don't have to remember anything, right? You don't have to remember what you said to whom. And you're just always trying to tell the truth. Not in a hurtful way or anything like that. We talk about speaking truth in love. Some of us forget the love part. But we'll talk about that in a moment. Integrity makes life smoother. Now, if that's the case, I mean, if what we're saying is true, if integrity pleases God, if integrity affects the people around me, if my consistency, and maybe that's another word, my consistency, my truthfulness, my honesty, all of that goes under the heading of integrity. If it affects others and if it blesses me, then how do I live with integrity? And let me give you a couple ideas and then we'll be done. I mean, if this really works, how do I do it? And I would suggest three things. Number one, always speak the truth. Always speak the truth. Proverbs 12:22 is a disturbing passage in Scripture. The Lord detests lying lips. Now think about that a minute, folks. What is it that God despises? Now, the Bible talks about a lot of things God despises, and we're quick to bring up the ones that don't apply to us. But here we are. God despises, detests lying lips. But he delights in those who tell the truth. He delights in those who tell the truth. Always speak the truth. Because God loves people who are truthful. Integrity demands that we always speak the truth. Now, we talked about Ephesians 4:15. We're going to speak the truth in love. And as we do that, we will grow up into him who is the head, that is Jesus Christ. To live with integrity means, you face the truth, you speak with truth, you deal with truth, you live in truth. Everything you do is about being honest and true. To take yourself away from falsehoods, even when it's inconvenient. I saw I don't know how it came into my feed. I do watch YouTube sometimes, and there was a story from Utah about a couple who bought an $11,000 piece of equipment, like a bobcat, to work on their backyard. They had this big backyard, and they were so excited they were going to finally be able to do what they wanted to do with their backyard. And they had begun to work on it, and somehow a few days later they discovered that the bobcat that was sold to them for $11,000 had been stolen. And so, what'd they do? They gave it back. They lost 11 grand. Why? Why did you do that? So the reporter asked. Well, because it was the right thing to do. It was the truthful thing to do. It was the honest thing to do. And so that's what we did. So you're truthful even when it's an inconvenient, even when you'd rather not be truthful, even if it's a difficult situation, because God demands that we live with integrity. Another idea, always speak the truth and always stand for what's right. 2 Corinthians 13, verses 7 through 8, Paul says, "Now we pray to God that you will not do anything wrong, not so that people will see that we have stood the test." He's been criticized. Paul's been criticized as an apostle, and he's saying, we want you to do what's right, but don't do it because we want people to think well of me. Don't do that because of that reason. But so that you will do what is right, even though we may seem to have failed. For we cannot do anything against the truth, but only for the truth. Now, we live in a country, a nation, that is absolutely obsessed with personal rights. Personal rights. Now, if there's a right, then, I mean, that's a moral word, isn't it? So there must be wrongs too. Rights and wrongs. And you know what? It turns out that sometimes what is my right may hurt you. And so I make a choice in integrity to do without my rights, so that you may be blessed. Now, we looked at this passage last week, and I'm just going to bring it up again because it just speaks so profoundly. How are we called to live, you and I, together in this world where truth has no meaning? where we are called upon and tempted to lie and cheat and steal. How do we live with one another? When people are insisting on their rights, how do we relate to one another? Be devoted to one another. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. That means I have to always ask the question, y'all hear that? That's feedback. I have to always ask the question, what is best for you? Not what do I want. If I live with integrity, I say what is best for you, even when it's inconvenient, even when I don't like it. Paul says the same thing in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Don't do anything out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself. Value others above yourself. And then he goes from there. Y'all know that's that famous passage where he talks about, you know, have this attitude or this mind in yourselves, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in very nature guard, did not regard equality with God, something to be grasped or to held on to. You want to talk about discipleship? You want to talk about what it means to live as a disciple of Jesus Christ? Here's what it means. This is what we're called to. We are called to reenact the humility of Jesus in the world, in all of our relationships, in everything that we do. We stand for what's right. And then the third thing is, we choose to live a clean life. And this also comes from Philippians. It says, live clean, innocent. The New Living Translation, live clean, innocent lives as children of God, shining like bright lights in a world full of crooked and perverse people. Boy, that was true of our world in the first century. It's true of our world today. And we have, that means we have a great opportunity. We have a great opportunity. Rather than to live the way the world lives and to do the things the world does and value the things the world values, we have an opportunity to show people what living is really all about. We have a great, great opportunity. We've been, it's not coming as any shock to anybody, we've been divided in this church family over serious, silly things to me, but we've been divided. And you can fill in the blank there. We have an opportunity to show the world how this thing is supposed to work. Right? I mean, we have an opportunity to show people this is how people who disagree get along. I mean, this is how people who are sometimes adamantly opposed to one another, this is how they live together in harmony and in love and in humility. We got to make a choice. We got to make a choice. Will we live with integrity? Let's pray. Father, you've called us to be your people. Father, I want to be more yours today than I was yesterday. And I want to be more yours tomorrow than I am today. But I struggle so much with this, Father. I am weak. And I fail every day. But I pray, Father, that you will work in my life, that the failures in my life, that they'll get further apart, that I'll draw closer to you. Father, this is our prayer in Jesus' name, in the powerful name of Jesus. Bring us together. Help us to love you. And help us to love one another. In the holy, powerful, lovely name of Jesus, we pray. And the church said, amen.
Take my life, make it your home. Lord, live through me, for I am not my own, but with a price, the blood of your Son. Nothing I've earned, but by your grace I come. Lord, take my heart, make it your throne. Lord, reign in me, for I am not my own. Lord, reign in me, for I am not my own.
Communion is the act of sharing something. In a religious context, we are sharing the body of Christ. Outside of Sunday mornings, how are we communing with each other? Participating in community has been difficult over the past year. Things are finally returning to normal, or at least the new normal. And it's so important that we actively allow time for community in our schedules. Over the past year, we have replaced Sunday and Wednesday night gatherings with TV shows or family pizza nights. We are personally guilty of this, and while I enjoy eating on the patio at Alamo Cafe with my family of four on Sunday evenings, it's time for my family to get back into community. It is what God has called us to. It is good for our souls, but it also nourishes our brothers and sisters as well. As we take communion this week, I encourage you to think about how you can start incorporating more spiritual community into your daily life at your current pandemic comfort level. Whether you join a ministry like Loaves and Fishes, invite an unfamiliar face to join you for dinner this week, or become part of a life group, I hope you don't wait too much longer.
I want you to try and finish this statement for me. It's from Hebrews 10:25. Do not forsake the... Okay, yeah. I heard some gathering, assembly. I've got to admit, if I've quoted that verse in the past decade, it's probably been with some level of sarcasm. Because I've heard that verse weaponized and used to scare people to come to church on Sunday night or Wednesday night. And that's not what the verse is about. But I think the Spirit of God is trying to tell us something in that verse. Hebrews 10:24 through 25. Let us consider each other carefully for the purpose of sparking love and good deeds. Don't stop meeting together with believers, which some people have gotten into the habit of doing. I can relate. Instead, encourage each other, especially as you see the day drawing near. Thank you for being here this morning. Thank you for encouraging me. If you've got your communion packet, let's go ahead and take that out now. Luke 22:19 through 20. And Jesus, after taking the bread and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the bread. In the same way, he took the cup after the meal, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant by my blood, which is poured out for you." Church, let's take the cup together. Our Lord and Father, our God, you are compassionate, you're gracious, you're slow to anger, overflowing with loyal love for us and faithfulness. We draw near to you because of your sacrifice, the sacrifice that you made through Jesus Christ. And we have faith that you have made us clean from our sin, and you have chosen us for your purpose. Your promises are reliable because you are reliable. We receive these symbols, the bread and the cup, and we receive your grace. Amen.
Coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you, Jesus.
I have to tell you, I agree with Luke. To see your faces, to hear your voices, wow, what an amazing morning to worship our Lord together. Am I right? Okay, I was fixing to say, surely somebody else is excited we get to worship God today. We are so glad all of you are here today and have worshiped with us. If you have not done so already and you would like to give, and we encourage you to do so, you can do that now. You can text a dollar amount to 210-940-4401. I always do that wrong. You can give online at nscoc.org/give. You can mail in a check or use bill pay through your bank, or you can drop an envelope in one of the offering boxes in the back. We are excited to announce that we have that our interns are here this summer for the youth and the children's. There they are. We have got, on the outside, you see Emily Padgett and Christopher Potter. They are the youth interns this summer. And in the middle, you see our very own Sarah Pippert. And they are already hard at work helping our youth and our children this summer. So we're really excited to have them this year. Hang around right after this here in the Worship Center at 10:15 for our adult Bible class. There's also children's Bible classes in the Sparklers area, and there's some in the nursery area as well. This afternoon, it's a new time, at 6:30, from 6:30 to 8:30 at McAllister Park is the youth activity today. Ben asked that you meet at Pavilion 2. Sorry, I had to look at my notes. Meet at Pavilion 2, but just make sure you note that that's a new time, 6:30 to 8:30. Next week is a busy Sunday morning for Northside. Not only are we adding an additional Bible class that morning, Bible classes will start at 10:30. We'll be from 10:30 to 11:30 next week. One Bible class will be in here. It's Amos, Prophet of Justice. That will be David Allen giving that Bible class. And then across the hall in the fellowship room, Living Jesus Lessons from the Sermon on the Mount will be a Bible class with Travis Holland, Don Shaw, and Sharon Utley teaching that one. Next week is also Promotion Sunday for our littles. So if you are here this morning and you've got kiddos, they need to stay in their school year. They just finished or they're finishing up this week. And next week we will do Promotion Sunday. It is also, next Sunday is Club 66. So if you've got a kiddo, whether it's your child or a grandkid that's working on those books of the Bible, if they get them done by Wednesday, let me know. And we would love to honor them next week and to show that they are working hard to learn those books of the Bible and bring the Bible into their hearts. I think I got it all. All right, now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or even imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Let's be standing as we sing. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Shout the victory.
Amen. Have a great week.